this video, we're going to learn Urysohn's Lemma. This is one of the most important theorems that we have in topology, and it is very important because of two things. First of all, the proof for this lemma is not trivial at all. It's a proof that uses very deeply the density of the rational numbers in the real line. Second of all, this theorem has many applications. The most well-known ones are the Urysohn's metrisation theorem, TSJ extensions theorem, and one theorem in analysis that uses this lemma is one of the versions of Ries' representation theorem. This lemma is also a characterization of normal spaces. Before jumping into the video though, let me remind you that you can support the channel in many different ways. You can make small donations or become a member on Ko-fi. If you become a member, you get access to exclusive content, such as the boards that we use for each video, and early access to boards that haven't been published and videos that haven't been published. If in addition to all that early access and content, you want to get merchandise, then you can become a member on Patreon. That way, you'll also get stickers, mugs, hoodies, t-shirts, and many more things. But if all you want is the merchandise, then you can visit our store and buy the items you want individually. Well, let's start with this theorem. We have X, a topological space that is normal. If you don't remember the definition or the properties for normality, then check out a few of the videos that we have on that. We have two closed and disjoint sets in X, A and B. Then what the theorem tells us is that there will exist a continuous function from the space X to 0, 1 that takes the value 0 for all the elements in A and the value 1 for all the elements in B. And this theorem, if you know a thing or two about analysis, might not seem like surprising, because in analysis, to build a function like this, what you would do is you would take a step function and then just modify it by doing the convolution with a function in, for example, the short class. So this theorem might not be surprising, but what is incredible about it is that this space X is just any topological space. It's normal, and asking for normality sounds like a lot, but it's just any topological space, so it's a very strong theorem. Now, something important to notice is that the converse of this theorem is trivial, is always satisfied. If we have these two sets A and B that are closed and disjoint, and there exists this function that works this way, then the space is normal. And that is not so hard to see, because what we have to do is we have to find the neighborhood of A and the neighborhood of B such that they are disjoint. And if we consider in the 0, 1 the subspace topology, then sets such as 0, 1 third open here, this is an open set in 0, 1 with a subspace topology, where the space is just a real line with the standard topology. And so the preimage of this set is open because the function is continuous. Well, let's call this set UA. So UA is an open set in the topology of X, and A is contained in UA, because in particular we're taking the preimage of 0, and f of x is 0 for every x in A. Well, in a similar way, we can take the interval 2 thirds 1. This interval is open in 0, 1 with a subspace topology, and so the preimage through f is also open. Let's call this set UB. Well, B, again, is a subset of UB, because in particular we're taking the preimage of 1, and f of x is equal to 1 for every x in B. But also, UA and UB are disjoint. And so this gives us that x is a normal space. Urysohn's theorem is actually the complicated part of this theorem, which is, well, we have to find this continuous mapping. The proof is a bit long, so this video will be separated into two parts. And the objective now will be to find a way of using the density of the rational numbers that we have here in the 0, 1 to find sort of a dense family, a dense collection of sets in X. So it's not exactly going to be a dense collection, but it's going to give us that impression. Well, let's get started with the proof. Well, let's start giving some names. We will denote by P the set of all the rational numbers in the 0, 1, because the rational numbers are countable, P is going to be a set like this, formed with x of n's for xn, a rational number in the 0, 1. But we will give P some sort of order. Given that this set is indexed in a countable set, we'll just order it so that the first element is 1 and the second element is 0. And for all the rest, we don't care. It can be just any order that we want for the rational numbers in the 0, 1. And to define this family of, in a way, dense sets in X, we will start by defining the first one. U1 is going to be the first of those sets, and it's going to be the whole space minus B, where B is the set that we have here from the theorem that we want to separate from A. Because A and B are disjoint, then we have that A is a subset of U1. U1 is obviously open because B is closed, and we said that A was closed. So now we will use another characterization that we saw normal spaces had to say that that will exist, given that we have a closed set and the neighborhood of that set, there will exist some sets, let's call it U0, in the topology, so an open set in the space, such that this happens. A is a subset of U0, and the closure of U0 is a subset of this open set U1. So here we have, in a way, some sort of density, because we started with A and, well, the whole space minus B. Put this all in there, and we found another set here, U0. Well, but now we want to get deeper and deeper in this density to have more of this set, and such that anytime I have two sets, well, there will always be one in the middle. So basically what we want to do is to have a given P and Q numbers in P, where P is smaller than Q. We want to find two sets, UP and UQ, in the topology such that UP is obviously contained in its closure, this is trivial, and the closure of UP contained in UQ. So anytime we graph two rational numbers, one smaller than the other, we have these two sets, P and Q, such that this happens. So this is what I meant by density, because now given any two rationals, we will be able to find these sets. And rationals are dense, so in a way this gives us some sort of density in X. How will we go ahead and build these sets, because we have almost nothing all we know about our space, is that it's normal. So we will build these sets by induction. For that, we will define Pn to be the first n elements in P. So it's going to be x1, x2, and so on, up to xn. And we will suppose that we have this for each P and Q in Pn. Well, this is our inductive hypothesis. So now what we want to do is use this inductive hypothesis to find the set for Pn plus 1. So Pn plus 1 is going to go up to xn plus 1. So let's consider that element, xn plus 1. This element will have an immediate successor and an immediate predecessor in Pn. Because what's happening here is, let's say that this is the interval 0, 1. We said that 1 and 0 were the first elements in P. So they will be in Pn for every n greater than 2. And then we have just a finite amount of elements xn in P. And now we're taking the xn plus 1. Let's say that it's some number here. What we're saying is that this number here will be the immediate predecessor, and this number here will be the immediate successor. And this will always happen, because if xn plus 1 was here, then we have that this number would be the predecessor and its successor would be 1. So because we started with 0 and 1, we always have this thing guaranteed. Every time we graph any rational number, we immediately have its immediate successor and predecessor in Pn. And for these two elements in Pn, we have this relation. So we are now focused on xn plus 1. Let's call this predecessor P and the successor Q. So let P and Q be such that P is going to be less than xn plus 1 and n plus 1 smaller than Q. Now for P and Q, because they are in Pn, we can use the inductive hypothesis and say that there will exist two sets, UP and UQ, in the topology, such that UP contained in its closure contained in UQ. This first one, we don't really need it. All we care about is this. But now the closure of UP is a closed set, and UQ is an element in the topology, so it's obviously open. So we have a closed set and an open neighborhood of that set. We can again use the normality of our space and have the guarantee that there will exist another set, let's call it U, X, N plus 1, in the topology, such that it's contained in the middle between these two. So we will have the closure of UP contained in this set. This set is trivially contained in its closure, but its closure is contained in UQ. This is again because of that characterization that we know for normal spaces. This is great because by induction we were able to prove that these sets always exist for any pair of points P and Q in P. Now that we have this, we will try and extend it for all the rational numbers, not just those that are in the 0, 1. And this is going to be easy because all we do is, if P is a rational number that is smaller than 0, then we will define UP to be the empty set. This is obviously going to be contained in any other set. And if P is greater than 1, we'll just define UP to be the entire space. And so, again, this one will contain any other UQ. So before finishing the idea, let's see what we have done. If this is our space X, we said we had the set A and B. We first defined U1. We said U1 was going to be the entire space minus B. So this set here, this is U1. Then we defined U0 to be some set here, such that its closure was contained in U1. And then we continued by induction. So if P sub n was, for example, it will always start with 1, 0, and then let's say we have 1 over 4. If we have this, then we would have to define the U sub 1 over 4. And that would be some set that has to be bigger than U0 and smaller than U1, because 1 over 4 is bigger than 0 and smaller than 1. So let's suppose that this set here was 1 over 4, u1 over 4. And then we continue. P, this would be p3. p4, let's say that was 1, 0, 1 fourth, 1 half. Now we would again need 1 half is greater than 1 over 4 and smaller than 1. 1 is the immediate successor and 1 over 4 the immediate predecessor. So the set u1 half would have to be somewhere around here. This is u1 over 2. And what happened is, if we continued like this, and let's say that p5 was, it starts the same, and the last element, let's say, was 1 over 3. Now, the immediate predecessor of 1 over 3 is 1 over 4. And the immediate successor in p5 is 1 half. So u1 over 3 would have to be between the purple and the yellow lines. And we proved that these sets will always exist. So we can always find this set here in the middle. And not only is it in the middle, its closure is also in the middle. So there's a big space between 1 over 4 and 1 over 2. So this is what I meant when I talked at the beginning of the video about the density that we were going to build in X. It's not exactly dense in the way that we know the definition of dense as a countable set such that its closure is equal to the space. I meant density in the form of we can just zoom in and there will always be something more in the middle. Well, now that we have defined all these sets, we are ready to define the function that will give us Urysohn's lemma. We'll continue with that in the next video.